Hi, I'm Jared. This is Pat. We're at NASA's Johnson Space Center inside of HERA, the Human Exploration Research Analog. This is Campaign 6, Mission 2 of HERA. Our mission is a simulated trip to Mars' moon Phobos to help scientists understand how confinement and isolation in remote conditions might impact or influence how astronaut crews live and work in deep space. We're really excited to be here, and we're looking forward to your questions.
Hi, my name is Anika, and I'm in 6th grade at the Cambridge International School in India. My question for you is, what research projects and experiments are all of you conducting while you are on HERA?
Hi, Anika. Fantastic question, because basically the research is why we're here. I think it's important to say up front that we are actually the research subjects. The experiments that are actually happening on the crew and our interactions. And that's part of what makes HERA kind of special. In order to do that, though, in order to kind of gauge our performance as a team, we have different activities and tasks that fall into three kind of general categories. Not formally, this is kind of how I think about it in my head, but the first are our operational tasks. And these are astronaut-like activities, such as simulated trips and surface operations to Phobos, where we get to use flight simulators and virtual reality to conduct that operation, which is really cool. These operational tasks have a scoring mechanism, and basically what that allows is the research to understand how the HERA environment might impact our performance. So through planning and practice and good teamwork, our scores will go up, but perhaps due to confinement or isolation, our scores could go down, and that's important for the researchers to understand. The second category falls into, we're trying kind of piloting some new technologies and ideas on trying to help crews operate farther from Earth. And so as astronaut crews go towards Mars and into deep space, the communication delay between Earth and the crew becomes longer and longer as we get farther and farther away. So the crews are going to kind of be on their own. They can't just call up mission control and get help whenever they need it. And so we're looking at technologies like virtual assistants or augmented reality to try to see if those technologies can help crews operate more independently when they're on long distance missions. And the last category is just some experiments similar to what you might find on the International Space Station. We're growing lettuce in a hydroponics bay. We sample the surfaces for microbial contamination. And the only purpose for those experiments is kind of immersion for us as a crew to make us feel like we're actually on a deep space exploration mission. So the output from those experiments are not part of the data that's being collected for here.
Hi, my name is Claire. I am in second grade at the Wilson School, Clayton, Missouri. My question is, how big is HERA?
Hi, Claire. So, HERA is 636 square feet, which is about the size of two classrooms. Right now, we're standing on level one of HERA. So, within this area are workstations where we do science-related missions, and we also do simulations to the Mars moon of Phobos. It also contains the hygiene module, where we have a bathroom and a shower. Above us on level two is a living area, where we also have a galley where we can prepare meals and eat them. It also contains an exercise area with a bike so we can do interval training, and also weights so we can do resistance exercise. Above that is level three, but level three is unlike level one or level two in that it doesn't have a floor. It's really just bunks where we can sleep. So we climb a ladder and we climb into our bunks. So it requires us to really coordinate the activities between all four of us so that we can work and live together in this small space.
Hi, my name is Olivia, and I go to Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University. My question is, because of your heavy workload and strict routine, do you notice any changes in your appetite? Hopefully you don't forget to eat. Thank you and keep up the good work.
Hi, Olivia. It's a very, very important question. And I think it's kind of interesting and relevant for our current times. The comparison I have is before I came into HERA. It was during the pandemic and I was working from home a lot. And so I felt like I really wasn't moving through the world as much as I was before COVID happened. And as a result, even though I was working out regularly, my appetite dropped quite a bit. Now that we're here in HERA, we're constantly on the move. We have a very busy schedule. We're constantly climbing the ladder between level one and level two. And on top of that, we also work out 6 days a week. So while I have seen a little increase in my appetite, I think it's largely attributed to the fact that we're just moving around so much more. Those increased activity levels required a little bit more caloric intake. Pat, do you have anything?
If you've ever gone camping, you've probably eaten a lot of the food that we eat here. So a lot of the food we have is a lot of prepackaged and dehydrated foods. And what we do in the galley up on level 2 is we add water to it to rehydrate it.
My name is Lauren Ann, and I'm a graduate student at the Florida Institute of Technology. My question for you is, how do you truly measure the effects of isolation if subconsciously you know you are still on Earth? How would you account for that extra level of stress that outer space might add? Thank you.
Hi, Lauren. That's actually a really important question. So it's important to note that our mission isn't really to simulate those aspects of long-duration space flight. We simply couldn't do that here. But what we do provide scientists is a baseline of data that they can use to try to determine what effect the stressors have on us and ultimately what it will have, the effect it will have on astronauts. So all the things that we have to live through, like isolation and confinement, those are all things that they can measure with us and create metrics. And hopefully with those metrics, they will then be able to determine and predict how that will have an impact on astronauts when they're doing long-duration space flight. These kinds of things will be very important to know as we stretch out further to the moon and to Mars.
Hello, my name is Matias Chiriboga, and I am in 10A at San Jose La Salle in Quito, Ecuador. My question is, what effect does your mission have on the human body and on human health?
Hi, Matthias. That's actually a great question, and it gets to the very heart of why we're here. So all of us here in HERA are actually test subjects, and part of that means that we are having our health and our vital signs recorded constantly. One way that they do that is we all have these wearables that we wear, and what these do is these allow scientists to track our heart rate and other metrics. In addition to that, we also routinely provide blood samples. So medical doctors here at NASA can look at that and get a baseline for our health and continue to track our health over a long period of time, especially as we're within this isolated, confined environment. Those things are really important because for astronauts, when they are going out to the moon and Mars, they're going to be in these confined, isolated environments as well over long duration space flight. And it's going to be very difficult for them to be able to get to a doctor. So by doing this, we're providing a baseline of data for scientists now so that they can have a better idea of how they can track and help astronauts in the future as they travel to the moon and Mars.
My question is, what challenges do you have to overcome to be successful inside of this unfamiliar environment? Thank you.
Hey, Daniel, that's actually a fantastic question because it really gets to the heart of the research we're doing here in HERA. And there have been quite a few challenges that we have to overcome. We have confinement in this rather small space. We have the isolation from our families and from the outside world. And then we also have some engineered stressors, such as our communication delay with mission control. We don't have immediate support from them because we're simulating the communication delays that's going to be present when the crews are operating long distances from Earth. And so for our team, I think really the key to our success has been really great teamwork. Because we're operating in such a small confined space, we've created rules and agreements and boundaries on how we're going to operate and live so that we can be successful, but also be successful as a team. And it's kind of a tall order. I mean, most astronaut crews have a long period of time to grow together as a group before they go on a mission. We went from pretty much complete strangers to a crew in 2.5 weeks. We all come from different parts of the country. Two of our crew members, Mike and Pietro, who are on the other side of the camera, taking care of us on that side, originally grew up in Europe. And so we all bring very different perspectives and experiences to this mission. And that's critical to the mission that we're doing here, but also future research at NASA, because we really have to understand is that space exploration has become a multinational endeavor. And being able to bring diverse crews together quickly to create a team and operate at very high stress levels and high operational tempos is going to be really important as we move further and further into deep space exploration.
Hi, my name is Sana. I'm an 8th grade student at Minaret College in Melbourne, Australia. My question is, how do you stay healthy on your mission? What happens if one of you gets sick?
Thank you, Sana, for that question. So, that's a very practical question. The answer is that we actually do a lot of the things that probably you do and a lot of your friends do. So first, we try to maintain a healthy diet. We have the benefit of NASA food specialists and nutritionists who have created a diet tailored for each one of us. In addition to that, we exercise on an almost daily basis. So that, along with a healthy diet, go a long way in keeping us healthy. Besides that, though, we also do have these wearables that we've mentioned before that are tracking our vital signs. So that also provides a lot of data that could provide an indicator if we start to get maybe a little unhealthy or a little ill. In addition to that, we have weekly consultations with a medical doctor and a psychologist. So all of these things together do go a long way in helping to keep us healthy. But you're right, there is still, with all those precautions, a chance that things can go wrong and we can get ill. And in a case like that, we can let Mission Control know that we have a serious illness and any one of us can be removed from here at any moment. So besides all of that, there's also the fact that we're all very careful before we enter the habitat too. So one of the important things that we all have to do is to be careful with COVID-19. We were all wearing masks whenever we were in public, and we're all fully vaccinated. So we've really done everything we can to maintain our health. And if anything else happens during our time here, we can be removed if that becomes necessary. But we really hope it doesn't.
Hi, I'm Anaya Alfred, and I attend California State University. My question is, how do you maintain your mental health while you're on your mission?
For me personally, it's a little bit of quiet time every day. We have access to music and movies. I have my stack of books here, so pretty much once a day, I'll kind of put some earplugs in and just kind of crawl into my own mind for a little bit and try to recharge. And the rest of the crew has been absolutely fantastic about making sure every one of us has that space and opportunity to kind of recharge in whatever way we need to. And so that's been a large part of how we've kind of honestly built up our teamwork, is by respecting that about each other. On top of that, we also have dedicated support from Johnson Space Center. So we have private psychological conferences every week. So if we do have some issues, we want to work something out, we have access to some professionals that are trained working with both the astronaut crews and the HERA crews. And so they're very experienced in these types of scenarios. And so they can give us really good, unique perspectives. But personally, for me, the most important thing is knowing that I have a loving family back home and that they're doing well. And so having that family, knowing that they're home, they're safe, that they're supporting me, and that we also have an extended network of family and friends that are supporting them in case something does happen, gives me a lot of mental resilience.
Hi, my name is Autumn, and I'm in second grade at the Wilson School in Clayton, Missouri. My question is, are you allowed to bring things from home on your mission?
Hi, Autumn. That's a great question. I'm glad you asked it because I came prepared. So first, just to start out as a reminder, like, our mission is to understand how isolation and confinement affects our behavior, and what may affect the behavior of astronauts as they move further and further away from Earth to conduct space exploration. And so it's pretty important that we don't bring in things like cell phones or connections to the internet, because they're not going to have those. Crews will not have that when they're on these long distance exploration missions. So it would contaminate the data, the research, if we had those available to us. Also, we can't bring in any work from our jobs back home, because that would divide our attention and take our energy away from the research we're trying to do here. We need to have all of our effort focused on the operational tasks that have been placed upon us, so that we can make sure we get good data for the researchers. They can then come around and develop the proper procedures and countermeasures to make sure crews are successful in space. That being said, we do get to bring a small amount of personal items with us. Here I've got a stack of books that I brought with me that I can use it during our free time in order to kind of unwind. I also brought pictures of my family with me. Here's a picture of my dog. She's a sweet little dachshund. I miss her quite a bit, but it's important to have these little mementos and reminders of our family back home with us on the mission. But it there's a balance, and I think it's important to mention this, in that while our weekly conversations with our families and the things that we personal items we bring with us on the mission are really important for our mental health, at the same time, if we're too connected to our responsibilities back home, then it may take our focus away from our mission. And this is something I experienced when I did deployments and exercises with the military. And it's a concept called an expeditionary mindset. And this is essentially an expeditionary mindset allows you to focus all of your mental, physical, and emotional energy on your tasks at hand. And so if you're too connected to things that are still happening back home, that will take some of that energy away from your operational tasks, and it could impact the mission. And this is a reality that's going to face our crews as they move further and further away from Earth. And so it's important, and an important part of the HERA research is actually trying to understand what that balance is. Pat, did you bring anything that you wanted to show?
Oh, well, you know, I brought books too, and I brought pictures of my family and my dogs, but I did bring one other thing. I brought a friend. This is Marvin. Marvin's helping us on our mission. You know, if we have any issues, we can just go to Marvin, and he might be able to help us while we're on Mars.
Subject matter expert. Thank you very much for all your questions. Really enjoyed answering them.
For more information, please go to the HERA website.